So hello everyone and a warm welcome to Capital Insider series. Today we are going to talk about an aspect which has been building a lot of highlight in the investment space, which is really deep tech and emerging tech. Since the last 2 years, a big focus for the entire funding community as well as tech community has sort of drawn a lot towards the space of deep tech as well as emerging tech, which could also be enabling machine learning, computer vision, artificial intelligence, and the likes of those. So today we are joined by Jatin over here. And, I was just talking to Jatin and he tells me that, before actually being the managing partner of Inflexor Ventures, he was also an entrepreneur himself. So that puts him in a very sweet spot because he really understands, how the founder's mind works. And then being an investor himself today, he can actually come and appreciate what the founder goes through. And therefore, the fund has just raised about 230 crores of its initial capital. And then, of course, there is going. It's a fund which aims to go up to 500 crore of corpus for making investments in young startups. So lovely having you here with us, Jatin. A great space that you have chosen, which is deep tech, and it's been catching eyeballs. And not just that, what I have interestingly noticed about deep tech is how they have been able to build and capture businesses in such a short period of time and become such large organizations. And of course, not just that, but the kind of impact that they create in the world in terms of really changing the way things happen. Has been really marvelous. So it's really good to have you here with us at Entrepreneur as we talk more about for the next 30-35 minutes about what the future of deep tech and machine learning is really going to be. So let me start by asking you a question which I'm sure you get asked several times, but I think it nevertheless keeps or maintains its importance. Is that deep tech is such a huge space. I mean, I've been studying it for the last 1 year as we write as journalists, but I also see that the space is becoming very crowded now. There's just so much happening. So do you think as investors, you put your lenses in some short sectors within deep tech, or is the spectrum very large? So what are the areas that you're looking at, whether it is software, hardware, or are you focusing only on certain sectors like, say, climate change or healthcare or, even probably drug discovery, as I see today, is using a lot of ML. So where particularly you see the trends going in deep tech, and as a fund, what are you focused on?
Sure. Thanks, Ritu, and thanks for having me and the kind introduction. So I think, it's a very good first question, right? How, at least as a fund, we see deep tech or how we define it, right? So for us, at a high level, the definition of deep tech is very simple, right? Any technology that will have a deep impact on the larger society is what we consider as deep tech. And sometimes what happens is, depending on the progress and the evolution, right, from our Industrial Revolution 1 to where we are today in 2020, the definition of at that point in time of what constitutes of deep tech keeps changing, right? So in the current context in 2020, where we are today, if applied to software, deep tech would encompass things like artificial intelligence, machine learning, augmented and virtual reality, right? Blockchain, big data. So these are the kind of things that would constitute on the software side what is deep tech. On the hardware side, obviously hardware always goes hand in hand with software, right? But on the hardware side, it would constitute things like IoT on the consumer side or industrial IoT on the enterprise side, robotics, stuff like that, right? Even cybersecurity, while it's software, cybersecurity also has a hardware component, right? So these broadly would be considered as, the deep tech ecosystem. And of course, if you fast forward 5 years or 7 years, right, some of these definitions may change. So as an example, quantum computing, which is a little bit more today in the R&D phase, right? And, it's not yet available to people like us, if you fast forward 5-7 years, that will replace something else, right? So the definition because of technology obsolescence will keep changing as we move along, right? And for us as a fund, we are sectorally agnostic, right? So vertical wise, we will do healthcare, fintech, consumer tech, right? All kinds of vertical. But you know, we have a horizontal theme of the investments in our fund, which is the deep tech, right? So as long as there is deep tech, tech IP, emerging tech used to solve a business problem, right? Practically, which has a market size, is where we invest. It could be hardware, it could be software. Of course, we prefer software because it's easier and low capex and all of that. But we have done investments in hardware, software combinations, you know, as well, right? So hopefully, you know, that answers, you know, at least at a high level, what deep tech is and how we look at it as investments.
So when you look at deep tech investments, I mean, and I'm sure, you know, at your end, you probably make these comparisons of Indian startups with the startups in the world within the deep tech space. So what do you find interesting? What are the trends that you see that are interesting in India from a world comparison perspective?
When we started our fund one, which is called Parampara in 2015, so of course we had started groundwork in 2014 for that fund. You know, we started with this theme and we said we will focus on B2B and B2B2C. And those were the days of only B2C. You know, people were building e-commerce and marketplaces left and right.
Correct.
So we were also given feedback by sort of our mentors or our people who we were interacting with, you know, in the VCPE world. But, you know, given our background, right? So we are serial entrepreneurs in the tech ecosystem in the past, as you had mentioned earlier. And we dealt mostly with B2B and enterprise technology. We thought, you know, we'll play to our strengths, right? And also we were new because, you know, we were part of the US startup ecosystem in the late 90s to early 2000. We have seen the dot-com boom and bust. We knew that for B2C, you know, the cash guzzling game, first-time fund managers with a relatively small fund size may not be the right thing anyway to focus on. Plus, it's not our strength. So when we started, a lot of apprehension, you know, as to how will you find deep tech companies in India? There's not much tech IP. India is good in services and B2C and stuff like that. But, you know, like having been associated with some of the campuses during the campus hiring that I used to do while I briefly worked for Bank of America in the past, I knew that there's a lot of activity definitely beginning to happen while it was still early. So we set up this small fund Parampara, and we were, you know, our apprehensions 5 years down the line today, you know, have been proven wrong, thankfully, right? We have found some solid deep tech startups in India, and half of the portfolio companies in Fund One have expanded globally, right, including to the developed markets, you know, sitting out of India. So India, as you know, has always been known as in the IT services world. So when globally anywhere people think of IT talent, India is always at the top of the mind, right? And that is perhaps what, you know, my generation sort of built the IT services side of India, you know, in the technology space. But what I see change now is, you know, the younger folks, right, who are either still in college or right outside out of college, their focus is shifting, right? So they are thinking more and more into developing tech IP, you know, and obviously tech IP, you know, deep tech will definitely get used. They are thinking of innovation. They are thinking of an entrepreneurship, right? Some of our founders have left, you know, 30, 40 lakh jobs out of campus to do their own startup, which is extremely risky, right? And we see that trend even coming from tier 3, tier 4 town founders who may be in Mumbai or Bangalore today, but, you know, these guys come from, you know, tier 3, tier 4 towns. So that all that is very encouraging. Of course, we have a long way to go, right? You know, number one still is US, and China is close behind the US. And, you know, we probably have at least half a decade to one decade gap, right, between where the US ecosystem and the Chinese ecosystem is. And that gap, perhaps when we started Fund One, was a lot more, which, you know, I'm happy to say that at least according to what we see has reduced a bit, but we need to still do a little bit of catch up.
Sure. No, I think we're going in interesting times that way, because, you know, there is always room for improvement when an investor from, you know, his lenses sees that there is still a lot of things which are happening over the world. And therefore, the scope for bigger business opportunities becomes all the more. When I see startups in deep tech, I mostly see that they have very solution-based approach to things, you know, so wherein they would typically help other businesses to improve their efficiencies, their productivity. Even if you look at a SaaS startup, I find that everybody who is right now I come across would be better to give their solutions to let's say other businesses, rather than having a business on their own, which is solution or to the industry itself. So do you feel that that's how the structure of deep tech startups or emerging tech likely to be? Or do you think they are going to be more focused on certain industries and therefore bring disruption and change within those industries? So what my question largely is, enterprise tech versus business tech, so to say.
Sure, sure. No. So I'll tell you, right, what at least we see and what has been happening for the last 10 to 15 years globally, and also obviously to some extent in India, particularly in the last 10 years. So we have the supply side and the demand side, right? So demand side are the consumers, supply side are the enterprises, right, that make those goods available to the consumer. So a lot of disruption has happened on the demand side, right, in the last 10, 15 years, which is where, you know, disintermediation happened, right? A lot of intermediaries got out, you know, marketplaces came up, right? Online e-commerce sites came up, delivery mechanisms got disrupted, right? You know, what Amazon did or what Flipkart is doing in India. You know, so a lot of work has happened there already, right? And it will continue to happen at a certain pace, no doubt, right? You know, and also, of course, deep tech is also very much valid in the B2C world or on the demand side as well. Where we see in the next 10 to 15 years, and we have seen that in the last particularly 3-4 years, is also on the enterprise side or on the supply side, they have lagged a little bit behind, right? Where the consumer revolution has happened, right? So now we see a lot of inward focus, you know, on using technology for innovation, right? And if you look at the global context, there's a lot of cheap money available, right? Particularly in the developed market. Plus these large companies are flush with cash. So there is a lot of inflationary pressure due to excessive liquidity, right? So companies are using some of these cash and using technology as a deflationary pressure, right? As you know, technology is always deflationary, right? Cost of computing keeps going down year on year, right? So they are using technology as a deflationary pressure, but more importantly, also to innovate, differentiate themselves from the competition, right? And improve efficiencies. And also given, you know, a lot more practical applications now of artificial intelligence, machine learning, industrial IoT, all of that is going to play out on the supply side as well, right? And thankfully, right, in a way, right, obviously COVID is a horrible situation to be in, right? But one of the bright spots, and, you know, as investors or as participants in the ecosystem, we always have to be cautiously optimistic. One huge plus that we see is even the traditional businesses who are on the sideline, right, waiting to get disrupted literally, right, with the tech wave that is coming across the world. We see, you know, a lot of increased interest from traditional businesses, brick and mortar places, that they've realized that they have to accelerate digitization, right? So a lot of, correct, you know, money is getting now spent on digitization, automation. And we continue that. We feel that next 10 to 15 years, that the supply side will accelerate a bit more than the demand side, right? Because they have lagged behind. And that's why that B2B focus that our fund primarily has, we believe will help the cause.
And you just mentioned digital transformation. Do you see a lot of deep tech startups actually sort of riding that wave and traditional businesses gaining more out of it?
Yes, yes, absolutely, right? And, you know, I have enough examples from our own portfolio companies, you know, that are making a huge impact. So definitely, I think deep tech startups have a huge role to play in all the digitization and the innovation efforts that are underway today. Yes. And this whole work from, sure. So it's a couple of examples, right? Even including from our portfolio, right? Like, you know, I would imagine that, you know, outside of the financial services and the tech industries as verticals, not all industries were geared up to do work from home or remote working, right? And the whole world has been doing that almost for 8, 9, 10 months now, right? So cybersecurity or data security, right, was not, you know, very well paid because, you know, people didn't expect people to work from home, right? Now, suddenly everybody has laptop and they are forced to work from home. So corporate data, enterprise data is at risk, right? So we have a couple of startups using deep tech, you know, AI, ML, cybersecurity, both for external threat as well as insider threat. You know, we are seeing a tailwind in that, right? Business has grown actually during COVID than it was pre-COVID. We have a couple of automation companies using AI, ML that help FMCG industries, media and entertainment, like particularly the OTT platform, which are also seeing a tailwind. So those startups, you know, like smart chatbots, which get deployed on e-commerce sites in absence of call centers, they are seeing a huge boom. EduTech and health tech, as you know, right, you know, are also seeing a big boom in during COVID.
No, absolutely. And I think I'm actually quite keen to see how manufacturing is going to look much different from, you know, what we have seen it in its traditional avatar particularly with the help of technology, how it could be more precision based and less wastage of resources and so on. So let's actually take one question which has come up from Anand. He says that when it comes to enterprise tech, particularly SaaS, there is a need of understanding domain and address unmet user needs rather patiently. This would mean a lot of patience in addressing existing customer base than focusing on capturing new customers. That is slow growth. Wouldn't that be opposite to VC plans?
I am, if I understood the question right, I slightly disagree with that. Of course, you see, domain knowledge is required in anything that you do in technology, right? Without domain knowledge, you can't solve the business problem. So of course, I agree to that, right? Obviously, domain knowledge is required. I think one example I can give from our portfolio company, how the shift to cloud has happened. So there was a company that we had invested in that had developed software IP for the infrastructure industry, right? So this company's software had gotten used in all the major infrastructure projects in India, right? You talk about the Delhi and Mumbai metro systems, or you talk about a lot of the buildings in BKC in Mumbai, right? And many other large infra projects. But when we invested, the limitation that company had was twofold, right? One was their software was not enabled on the cloud, right? So they were kind of selling mostly in India, right? Once they got their software enabled on the cloud, because this technology is required everywhere, right? Infrastructure is being built around the world. So once they moved to the cloud, the domain knowledge, of course, was the same. Of course, additionally, they had to factor in international building codes, for the structural engineering and analysis is that that's the domain that they were serving. But as soon as they became sort of cloud enabled, right, immediately the market suddenly became from India to global, right? And then, for young startups in an early stage, you could either sell outside India through digital marketing, or you could have channel partnership so that, you are not spending too much time and resources and you are giving it to some experts who are already doing that. And once you reach a certain large stage, you can do direct, feet on the street, or the founders or the key team members travel back and forth. So I somewhat disagree. I think, once you have software enabled on the cloud and you are solving a real life problem, your market suddenly becomes from a local market to a global market. Of course, you may start locally. So how, almost half of our portfolio company, they started in India on doing cloud software. So India is a price sensitive market, but it is more tolerant. If you have a couple of bugs here and there, it's a bit more. So we ask our companies to refine the product, get it right, right? Because, once you go outside, the tolerance on the bugs is a little less. They will pay more price for it. So that's the trade-off, right? Which is good in a way, quality of revenue. So then we make them go to Middle East and Southeast Asia, right? And then they go to the developed markets, US and Europe. But once you are on the cloud, it's just almost a switch, right? People in the US can use the same software that we are using here, right? So that's what I would say on the cloud side of it. In fact, I would add one more point. For us, the best investment is at the intersection of deep tech and cloud. If you have a deep tech solution which runs on the cloud, that is an ideal investment for us, frankly.
Sure, yeah. That makes a lot of sense, actually, from what is required today in that sense. So tell me on a more qualitative level, when you look at deep tech, what sort of qualities do you see in the founders? And what is the chemistry of the founder team or the founding team that you see typically in a deep tech startup, which you probably is different from, let's say, a more B2C or a consumer facing startup?
Sure. I think there's no real, standing out sort of characteristic. See, basic ingredients of any good founders, whether they are doing a B2C or a deep tech company, right? 90% of the ingredients are the same, right? These guys have to be, I call it practically passionate, right? You can be passionate, but it's also to be practical. So if you are committed, have high conviction, you are somewhat flexible to change with what the market is giving message to you and not be rigid that, hey, it's my baby, this is my way or highway, right? So some of the basic ingredients, plus, you are solving a real business problem where there is a large enough market size, right? And there is for investment considerations, obviously for us, the valuation and the exit potential. If all these ingredients are in place, in terms of the founder quality, I would only add that if you are really doing a lot of deep tech, at least one of the co-founders ideally should be a tech guy, right? Or, you know, like a computer science, or not necessarily computer, but you know, somebody who has done hands-on technology work in a similar area. I think that would be the only difference, I would say. See, otherwise in our portfolio, we have founders from Stanford to college dropout, right? So in terms of the educational background, frankly, it doesn't matter too much, right? As long as you have hands-on prior experience in a deep tech ecosystem that you are trying to work on and solve a business problem. Right? So in most of our startups, you know, ideally where there are two co-founders, for example, one of them will be very strong in technology, right? And the other one will be very strong in sales, marketing. So we look for these complementary skill sets, either in the co-founder team or the founder and key team.
Sure. And do you also see great opportunities for Indian deep tech startups to go global in the coming years? You think our product is being built not just for the Indian market, but also for addressing the global market? And then if at all global markets, then what are good markets to start with?
Sure. No. We definitely see, you know, global market potential for deep tech startups out of India. I mean, you know, at a very high level, if Indians can go to the US and, you know, build Google and Facebook and in fact lead Microsoft, there's no reason why we can't do it from India, right? And now the environment or the ecosystem is also changing, right? There is a lot of private capital available, which was not the case perhaps when I joined the job market, right? And the youngsters are willing to take a little bit more risk. They have more financial support, right? So I think risk-taking capability, and I think the taboo about failure is also less than what it was like 10, 20 years ago. So I definitely see, I think already we are seeing, particularly in the deep tech or the B2B side, right? We already have several companies now that do upwards of $50, $100, $200 million revenue, right? Only thing is we feel that the scale comes only when you go abroad, right? You know, so in India, you know, you can probably do the first 5 to 10 million in India, right? And then to scale beyond that, you know, like I said, the template that we have followed or most of our companies have followed is post India, they go to Far East Asia and Middle East, right? And they sort of get some traction there. And then they move to the US and European markets. And half of our companies in the portfolio have done this very successfully.
Sure. And given the fact that, you know, you've yourself done startups at Silicon Valley and you sort of understand the character of startups over there, do you feel that talent movement from there to India or talent movement from here to India to Silicon Valley, how could that sort of, I would say, change the entire growth structure or the growth plan of the deep tech startup, which was actually founded in India? Correct. So, you know, I mean, how can talent movement help Indian startups to become more robust, better, and therefore be able to achieve their growth targets faster?
Yeah, I think obviously it is very helpful. And since, you know, I spent most of my professional career in the US and have come back, and then, you know, our fund, you know, we call it the US-India corridor, right? You know, for the startup ecosystem. So where, you know, either, you know, there are Indian founders in the US who have a tech shop back in India, or there are Indian founders in India with a tech shop here whose major markets are outside of India, right? So that is kind of what we call the US-India corridor. And then there is talent movement back and forth. Sometimes what happens is, you know, beyond a certain point of traction, especially, you know, even including in our portfolio companies where there are two co-founders, once they hit a certain milestone, then one of the co-founders will go move to the US, right? So that there is one co-founder in India, one in the US.
Correct.
Right?
Yes.
We have also cases in our portfolio companies, right? We have a semiconductor automation company. So this founder has spent 22 years in Silicon Valley, you know, working in Intel, right? And he has come back to India post that. And, you know, started a startup that is solving problems that are faced by semiconductor companies, right? Large chip companies when it comes to testing and automation, testing automation of their chip design. So that's the US-India corridor part. And I think that needs to increase, you know, and happen more and more. One problem I have with is, you know, of course, India is moving up the value chain, right? One problem partially because of, you know, some of our uncertain tax policies or regulations, which has improved a lot, of course, lately. And secondly, our perception that India is more of a IT services heartland. You know, I see some startups, you know, having base in Singapore or, you know, having a legal entity in the US. Most of the work, of course, is happening in India. So there is a perception that same company in Singapore or US will get valued more if, as opposed to if you are only in India, right? I hope and I sincerely think that that changes over the next 5 to 7 years, both with, you know, better government policies, which are happening, right? I think government has been hugely supportive of the startup ecosystem. Plus perception internationally, once we have a few good, you know, outcomes from India in terms of growth and exits, I think that should change as well.
Sure. And, you know, let me ask you this, that particularly you've seen B2C era of startups, you know, in 2011, 12, 13, we had what you typically call e-commerce. And now I'm seeing that, you know, particularly 2015 upwards, I've seen there are more startups which have been sort of helping other businesses, which are very B2B and enterprise tech focused. From a growth standpoint, and, you know, I mean, how soon or how different you find these two ecosystems are? Do you feel that a B2B tech startup is able to sort of grow faster in their trajectory to, okay, let's say in a more, you know, parlance to become a path towards unicorn is faster versus a B2C startup, which is, you know, very consumer facing and therefore also has a big burn and investment towards acquisition of consumers. So, I mean, this is actually just an extension to the question of what the gentleman had earlier asked about, you know, keeping the pace of growth.
Right. No, so I think, you know, obviously, you know, in the Indian context, right, we are 1.3 billion people, of which, of course, 300 to 400 would what we would consider middle class. So the growth obviously will always be faster in the in a B2C side than on the B2B side. But on the flip side of that is the failure rate and the capital requirement, all of that also will be much higher on the B2C side, right? For every Flipkart, I'm sure there are 1,000 B2C companies that have failed or even more, right? Whereas that ratio may be a little bit better on the B2B side, right? On the B2B side, you know, in the first 3-4 years, if you are growing 2x, 3x, right, that's considered good growth year on year, right? I'm talking of CAGR. And then in, then you double every year for the next few years, I think that would be considered good growth and you will get good valuation if you are a, you know, a cloud-based software play, for example, right? Whereas on the B2C side, of course, you know, there is no consideration of how much capital you need or when you will be profitable. But if you can make, you know, 5 million people download your application, right? You know, you'll be valued at 250 million right away. So I think that that's the slight difference. There are both pros and cons of it. But B2B definitely is changing. So, you know, just to your point, you know, when you started the question, as of the NASSCOM report of 2019, right, in the last 5 years, you know, from that report, in India, about 9,500 startups got created, right? 43% of those were in B2B. Right. So in, if you had done the same survey in 2015, you know, you would probably find 5 or 10% in B2B. Right. So that's the shift that has happened to your point. Right. That B2B focus has increased and 18% were deep tech. Right. And now what we see, at least our view is internal view is as we move forward is to be roughly at 50-50 between B2B, B2C. And but within the B2B, the deep tech component will increase further.
Sure. And do you think the pandemic in one sense has sort of slowed down the growth for deep tech startups? Or do you think, in fact, because the need for digitization and need for this transformation is so much higher that even if there's been a slight slowdown, it's only going to come back bigger and faster in 21?
Correct. No, so I think, you know, except I would say for April, May, June, right? So which was the first quarter of this financial year where we saw some slowdown, right? I think it has come back with a bang, right? The whole deep tech and, you know, digitization, automation enabling companies like that, you know, it has pretty much, in fact, I would say that we are almost back to pre-COVID level in terms of the activity. And the valuations which had gone down a little bit also have come back to almost back to pre-COVID levels, at least in the sector that we operate in, right? And we are seeing a lot of activity. And thankfully, right, and also, again, going back to your B2B, B2C question, right? All the companies, none of the companies in our portfolio have failed, right? In, despite of COVID. So they've all survived. And on the other side of the problem, right? You know, whoever has survived will be able to garner more of the market share, right? So which is what we feel very good about, right? Whereas in terms of B2C, if you had ran out of money at the start of COVID, right, you would have to shut down. Whereas in B2B, yes, you can kind of control a little bit better the levers.
Yeah, that's true in one sense, you know, because obviously you don't have the B2C problems, which is to always, you know, bump up your numbers of customers. You can still probably be a little more relaxed when it comes to your customer size in the B2B space. So, you know, finally, before we sort of, I know we're almost at the end of our time. So, but finally, let me ask you this, that, you know, if, so, you know, there is this obviously new business model, which is B2B2C, which is becoming, you know, the talk of the town, so to say. And particularly from a deep tech startup, how do you define a B2B2C model? I mean, you know, what, how does the business model really work? What part is B2B? What part is B2C? And therefore, how do the founders plan their entire business to be able to, you know, garner their numbers or meet their growth targets?
Correct. So we have a few B2B2C companies. So we, like I said, right, our fund primarily focuses on B2B. But, you know, we have two consumer tech companies in our portfolio, which were also pure B2B companies when we started. So these were, so for example, right, we had a super energy efficient smart appliance maker, which had used deep tech, you know, to solve some of the problems. So they were selling to other businesses, right, who were in turn selling to finally the consumers, right? So now, you know, whether you sell via Amazon, right, in a way, while it is B2C, you are actually dealing with Amazon and Amazon is dealing with your consumers, right? Or, you know, in the case of this appliance maker, they sell it to the retail stores who then sell it to consumers, right? So I think, you know, while largely, you know, the hustling required and, you know, the skills required of sales and marketing will not change too much. B2B requires a little bit more focused approach, right? Because you can't burn your way through the B2B2C or the B2B sales and marketing functionality, right? Whereas in B2C, you can bombard people with digital marketing or give a lot of freebies, right? And, you know, Indian consumers are smart. Some of them will try it also, right? When you're giving things for free and, you know, discounted models, right? So, you know, the hustling and all that required is the same, I think. Only thing is, you know, you are dealing with another business to sell your products who will then sell to consumers, right? So I think, you know, the sales cycles may be longer, but they are, you know, not as expensive as you would do for B2C, right? That's the main difference, I would say.
So do you think post the pandemic, it would be a survival strategy for a lot of B2C tech startups to actually start thinking B2B?
I think the ones that are well-funded, you know, actually will gain more market share, right? The ones that were struggling financially, I think will die down, right? I think we've already seen a lot of that, right? You know, even before COVID, you see the number of closures. But I think whoever survives will, of course, have a bigger share of the pie. And India is still huge, right? I think, you know, the China inflection point, while I'm not a B2C guy, right? You know, I just share one anecdote. The China inflection point came, you know, when they moved to like a $5,000, you know, per capita income, $5,000 to $6,000 range, right? India has been stuck at this 2,000, 2,500, you know, per capita number. And, you know, that inflection point where we want to move the pace that China went is kept getting delayed, right? Once India hits that $5,000 to $6,000 per capita, we will see a further huge boom. So, I mean, you know, B2C still has a lot of potential in India, clearly, right? We believe. It's nothing
but
wrong that with that.
It's likely to come down rather than go up, at least for a short term.
Yeah. Of course, you know, I'm not an expert, so I have to have a disclaimer and, you know, I'm a B2B enterprise guy, right? But of course, we have enough knowledge about what's happening in B2C. Unfortunately, you know, before Jio stepped in, B2C was left to all the big foreign players, right? The domestic guy had no chance. It's controlled by Amazon, Alibaba, Walmart, even today, right? So.
Sure. Just a second. There is another. What are the great opportunities to invest in B2B? Sameer is asking.
Like I said earlier, right? In B2B, a lot of traditional industries, right? be it brick and mortar or be it traditional manufacturing, you know, some of them who have been very resistant to technology, right? And unfortunately, they don't know what is going to hit them, right? Unless you are on monopoly businesses, right, where, you know, you don't have to worry too much about disruption, at least for now. If you are in a business that is not monopoly, a tsunami will disrupt you, right? So I think the way you are able to convey that, right, and you find what are the problems that can be solved in this context, and you can pick the right vertical of your choice, right, whether it's health tech or manufacturing or, you know, consumer tech or fintech, right? I think, you know, there is obviously huge potential where tech has not interfered too much. Like manufacturing is a very good example, right? We see 3 or 4 trends that are happening in manufacturing, right? So there is a computer vision based, you know, behavior analytics and shop floor monitoring of behavior analytics to increase efficiency. There is this whole concept of digital twins, you know, which is part of Industry 4.0, where you simulate the shop floor in a digital environment and do predictive analysis and, you know, improve efficiencies and reduce breakdowns, right? Stuff like that, you know, a lot of activities going on. Obviously, there's robotics, right? There's 3D printing. So there's a lot of opportunity in all of these areas. Only thing is, you know, in India, there's a lot of resistance still, right? Which hopefully, like I said, will change post the pandemic. I think some of our investors who are also in traditional businesses, you know, they have made a very conscious attempt to get themselves familiarized and also actually invest in our fund, right? To get become part of this whole digitization and automation journey.
Sure. So just got a question that Virendra is asking, what is your take on healthcare IT startups as a VC?
Oh, healthcare, health tech, you know, as we say, healthcare IT is assuming that's what you mean, right? Obviously, you know, it has been one of the biggest beneficiaries in the time of COVID. And if you see some activity in the public markets, particularly in the US, right, where it comes to telemedicine or whether it comes to artificial intelligence or machine learning companies that accelerate drug discovery, right, stuff like that. We actually are looking at a AI-based radiology company, radiology startup out of India, right? So this company has developed machine learning models to read CT scans, right? And, you know, if you go to a site where their software is installed, besides your regular CT scan report, you will get this AI-ML-based startup's report, the quantitative insight report. And a combination of the two reports will give you very good diagnosis and hopefully better treatment, right? So there is a lot of stuff like that happening. Also, obviously, on India is in bad need for, you know, low-cost medical devices. There's, of course, activity happening on the low-cost medical devices side also, as has been exacerbated during COVID, right, with all the ventilators and all of that happening. So there's, of course, it's a huge potential area, health tech overall, and it's one of our favorite sectors as well as a fund.
Sure. So we'll take this one final question. While it's very generic, but you might still want to comment on this. With the fallout of SoftBank, Amazon going direct and China fallout, what do you think is going to be the impact on Indian economy?
I think China, geopolitically, what happens with China, and I don't think it's only an India-China thing, right? It's a global versus China thing. It will have an impact because there are a lot of Chinese capital coming to the Indian startup ecosystem, as you are all aware. SoftBank, of course, had some bad news, particularly on the WeWorks and a couple of other things that went down. But I think, you know, these guys always have a tendency to come up. In fact, I don't know if you follow, right? SoftBank has come back strongly since those March, April lows, right? Even as a publicly traded company on both Tokyo and New York stock exchanges. So they've recovered significantly from where they were. I think, as part of the VC ecosystem, right, we used to see a lot of American, Chinese, Japanese capital come in when we started, right? And then, you know, more recently, Korean capital has started coming in. Some European capital has started coming in. So there will always be, you know, capital that will get replaced. And I think, you know, thanks to what Jio is doing, right, they are trying to convert themselves from an oil and gas company to a tech company. Hopefully, you know, even the domestic large industrial houses will also become part of the startup ecosystem as far as capital investments are concerned. Jio has themselves bought so many startups in the recent times, right? So we also want the domestic large industrial houses to participate in the ecosystem in terms of capital.
Sure. Do we have time for one final more question, Jatin.
Sure.
There is so gentleman is asking, as deep tech needs go deep in solutions, what is good? Organic growth, balanced growth, or hyper growth?
I mean, you know, for startups, there is only organic growth, right? There is no inorganic or hybrid growth, right? Startups cannot go and acquire companies. So if you are talking of early stage startup particularly, of course, you know, it has to be organic. When you reach a startup at the level of a Flipkart and a Baiju, right, obviously, then you can do that hybrid, both organic and inorganic growth. And as you know, right, all these, both of the companies I mentioned have bought a bunch of other startups, right? So I think, you know, for early stage, it has to be organic. I don't think there is a choice.
Sure. So, you know, with that, we're almost at the end of the time. But thank you so much, Jatin. I think this was a very useful talk and certainly a great way forward for a lot of young startups in the deep tech space who are trying to build significant businesses out there. You know, we took a few questions that came along the way, but always happy to answer more questions that come from our audience. Please feel free to put your questions on this talk on Facebook or LinkedIn or wherever you like. And we will request Jatin or his organization if they can actually take a few minutes to answer these questions back to everyone. Jatin, this was really useful for a lot of young startup companies who are building their businesses and looking to grow large in this space. As you say, the opportunity is very big. Digitization is the way forward. Automation, whether it's in manufacturing services or other sectors, is the only way that a country can really make a good shift and businesses can think of a good survival strategy post-pandemic times, which we are looking to go towards. And hopefully the next time, while, you know, digital is the order of the day, but hopefully next time when we have a talk, it will be in person rather than in across the screen. Just to make the impact bigger. Absolutely. Any final words from you, Jatin?
No, I think, you know, thank you so much for having me. And if there are any entrepreneurs who are either participating now or future, you know, like I said, you know, we are looking for always good founders and good startups in the deep tech ecosystem. Please feel free to apply to us, right? You know, and, you know, you can go to our website, inflexor.vc, and apply as well, right? So look forward to helping many more entrepreneurs in the startup ecosystem in India and have a mutually beneficial relationship with all of them. Yeah. With that, you know, thanks.
Thank you very much once again.
For your time. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Jatin.